How's it going, guys? Matt here with Carolina Coops. Welcome to Video Chicken. To my left is my host, Kristen Warren.
I think this one really could be a male.
Oh, we got one that's hatching? This show is for you guys. This is the bass fiber. Y'all know chickens are the gateway drug into homesteading.
We survived with only one trip to the ER.
Coyotes are everywhere.
It's about time you show up, Matt.
Uh-huh. It's a great straw.
It is time, finally, for chicken police. They defecate every 12 seconds. Is that true? Now it is officially noon because the buzzer went off.
Well, I've never counted.
That's long
more
road.
Coops.
That's a good one with the cords and everything.
And more chickens.
Well, the math you do now, Daddy, is chicken math.
Calm down, what? Matt. But calm down.
I'm just trying to help you out, Ingrid. That's all. I'm sorry. I was getting ready. What's going on, guys? I love that promo. Happy Friday. Everyone's here. Everyone was early today.
I have
some questions coming up.
Yeah, I know.
You're welcome. What's going on, guys? My name is Matt. Welcome to Video Chicken Live, brought to you by Carolina Coops, the world's best chicken coop production company. To my left, my co-host, Kristen.
Hello.
Our chicken expert, sales girl. And, of course, behind the computer over there is the wonderful Ingrid doing her thing. She is the proud owner of that promo, or producer of that promo, which mm-hmm. is awesome. Hope you guys are doing well. Today is what was today? December 17th.
It is the 17th.
It is December 17th, 2021. We are live right now. We have an awesome show. I am so excited about today. I could barely sleep last night.
Mm-hmm. Really?
Yes.
Like Christmas.
It's going to be kind of like Christmas. Today's show is all about, well, I'm sure we're going to talk about a lot of things, but we're going to try to focus on
chickens.
Yes. We're going to focus on chickens, chicken breeds. I saw that wonderful reels that Ingrid did yesterday. There's a little bit more information that I thought we were going to talk about. If you guys aren't following us on Instagram, please go there and you'll see the reel.
It's actually a story, but that's okay.
Story, reels.
Okay.
Newsfeed, I can't, see, you well, know.
The stories are only up for 24 hours,
I
right?
I know. I don't.
Unless you save them or something.
I guess. I, you know what? I never look at the stories and reels myself.
I do.
Really?
I do.
Okay. Mm-hmm. People are joining us. Thank you for being here. So we're going to talk about chickens today.
Yes. But we have to address Kathy's question.
Oh, we have a question already?
Don't we talk about chickens every week?
Chickens and coops, yeah.
Yeah, so people are already asking. I've got to know. I'm scared to know. What in the hell did you do to your head?
Well, I don't know if this is relatable, but last night, right at dusk, I was trying to catch one wayward chicken that keeps sleeping in a tree. And I had my daughter out there, and it was right at dusk, and we were trying to chase it into the chicken run. And I was crouched down, not looking up, and it was almost dark, and I ran right into a fence post. Yeah. Chasing a chicken.
Chicken-related injury.
Right, right. So it is relevant to the show, so a little stupid, but yeah. I think I almost got a concussion.
Well, so that just reminded me.
A chicken-related concussion.
That reminded me.
So dangerous keeping chickens. So
no,
dangerous.
It's not.
Many people can get concussed.
Yes.
So, I mean, I almost climbed a ladder to get the chicken out of the tree. What if I had fallen off the ladder and, like, broken my neck? That would have been like a chicken-related death.
Yeah, and then what are we going to do about sales?
I know. It's a good thing. It's a good thing I survived.
Good thing it's not working.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that is not non everyone.
My mic's not turned up.
Non said it was a good thing it wasn't.
No, we heard you.
Calm.
I heard you.
Yeah, you're loud and clear. All right, we'll do a mic check on Non. So we have had a heck of a week.
Well, aren't they all? I mean, you say that every week, so.
No, this was a heck of a week.
Is it?
So we left everyone hanging at the end of last week's show. It occurred to me that we may or may not be here today.
Why? Well, chicken-related injuries?
No.
Today we're all going to succumb to it.
Today was going to be a day off for you because you're supposed to be on your way to Florida.
Yes.
But I kind of kicked and screamed and I mm-hmm. said, you know, please, Kristen, just come for the video check and then maybe you can go. We'll see.
Right.
Anyway, so we're like, yeah, you will be here next week. And we're like, wait a minute. We may not be because we talked about a big site survey. Okay, way too much silence. Back me up here. We did a huge site survey. No, we're not going to name any names. Okay. Did we not have a great time?
We did.
We had a wonderful time.
Explain to people what a site survey is for those who don't know.
Okay. A site survey means if you are thinking about, and this can happen no matter if it's a custom coop or a production coop, people will ask us to come out and survey their land mm-hmm. and talk to them about really everything, chickens and, of course, chicken coops. And the most important thing is, you know, where should I put my chicken coop? And it's amazing every time we do this that people learn so much from us.
It really is, because it's a huge purchase and there has to be some thought and consideration in where you're going to put this piece of art.
You did it for me.
Yeah.
Before I even worked for you.
We right. sure did.
And did we end up putting it anywhere different than you had anticipated, or we just confirm what you were already thinking?
No, we put it where we talked about, but I also had I had a much bigger coop in mind.
Okay.
And then we kind of pared it down.
Did we do a good job?
Of course. Of course you did.
Because Rainer goes, well, I work for you guys now.
Yeah.
Yes. All right. That is what a site survey is. We have customers that we normally don't charge, truth be told. We do it for mm-hmm. free because that's part of the cost of doing business and trying to earn their business. But I love that we do have customers that, to get us out on the plane, you know, they pay for everything. And they just love these site surveys. They learn right. so much. And we even had a situation, you know, years ago in California where thank God we ended up going out.
Yes.
Because we would have had the customer... The size was not right. And this right. involved dynamite and the side of a mountain. It was nuts. So we did a site survey. What is it? I want to make sure I don't say it wrong because you guys criticize me. A-list? A-list?
Yeah.
So everyone, just so you know, we have...
It was actually good that I'm not familiar with this A-lister, though, because then he was like just totally another chicken person saying absolutely normal chicken customer things.
Why is
yeah, so apparently we decided not to shut the door today.
Oh, he just wants to goober me.
It's been a while since we have Gus in the studio. Anyway, yeah. So we had an awesome site survey. And I don't know if I could bring someone in just to share a quick story, because I tell you what, it was a great site survey. We're going to talk more about it in the future. What?
He got me all wet.
Oh, geez. We have visitors from New York in today. We have Mackenzie and Evan, who came down from New York for the site survey. Mackenzie, this was her first time doing a site survey. And I just thought real quick, I wanted to share the story real quick. We're going to get right into it, I promise.
Yeah. Is she going to sit down?
I wasn't sure if you want to share, have talked with her and share the story, or if you wanted to have her sit down.
Yeah, she should take my seat.
Yes. Yeah. We're gonna bring Mackenzie in. She is here in North Carolina.
She probably doesn't need the headphones.
Probably not, but just in case. Mackenzie, can you come sit down next to me?
Yeah.
We got lots to talk about real quick. And I'm gonna, and just to mentally prepare Mackenzie, I'm gonna put her on the spot, as I always do.
I just want to shout out to Fish and Matt Ryan, butter. Who made it, because he's out in California, and I know he's usually working.
Yes, Fish and Matt Ryan, how you doing?
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. Yay, Mackenzie, everyone.
Hi, everybody.
How are you doing today? Come on in. Yeah, because you're making me look like, yeah. So you hear us okay, though, right? Because you don't have the headphones on.
Yeah.
I don't know if you can hear me.
Yeah, you're sitting right next to her.
Well, but you're not going to hear Nan. You're not going to hear the audio. Whatever.
I usually don't have a problem hearing you.
No one does.
All right. So real quick, I wanted just to share with everyone that we went to, it's called an A-lister. Am I saying that right?
Yes. He's an A-list celebrity.
All right. And you were pretty excited about this A-list celebrity.
Oh, I was pumped.
Yeah.
I used to wake up, like my alarm clock was a song that...
Oh, it's a singer.
But, singer slash. A variation of that.
All right. So we did the site survey and, you know, how long have you worked for us?
Two and a half years,
going on 3 years.
A little over.
So long story short, you've never been out to actually see one of our coops.
No.
And this was your first time ever being out in the field for Carolina Coops. So what a way to hit it off with a A-plus celebrity. Anyway, so here's the point is, you know, you go to these homes, and we saw him. He's waving at the end of his mile-long driveway.
Oh, my God.
We're all like, ah, oh, there he is. That's awesome.
Like, that's him.
Super, super nice guy. There's going to be so much to come about this. But long story short, I will never forget the ending of our trip there. Now, it was short, unfortunately. We had a total of 14 hours of driving, round trip.
Yeah.
We met for an hour, but we got a lot done. And at the end...
It was very productive.
At the end, would you like to share the quick story?
I had asked, because none of my friends believed me. You know, I have a loud mouth, and I was like, I'm going to meet this person. They're like, yeah, okay. All right, Kenz. So I asked, you know, can I ask you a question? And if I'm being out of line, please say no. Do I need to be closer to this?
Yeah, you get used to putting your arms around the mic and not hitting it. There we go. Now.
Oh.
Go ahead.
I feel like a news anchor. So I asked him, would you take a selfie with me? And he was like, you know, why don't we wait until the whole thing's done and then we'll take a big reveal picture together. And I was like, okay, fair enough. Like I can deal with that.
How'd you feel?
I felt a little defeated.
I felt it for you.
I was like, well, and then I got in the truck and closed the door. I was like, no one's going to believe me. And I just came all this way. And they're going to be like, yeah, oh, he wasn't even there, was he? And then I closed the door and I looked over at Kristen. And then he came back around and was outside the window of the truck. And I popped the door open. And he goes, you know, tomorrow's not promised. So I would love to take a picture with you. So I got out and I took a selfie. And, you know, you have to do like one of the little kind of things at the end because it's like a touchdown dance, but in real life.
See, look, you're giving me goosebumps. I tell you what, you know
it meant like that. That means a lot to me.
That just what a great guy. So I can't wait to share what we're going to be doing for him with his Jim Coop. Evan was already up early this morning designing it. We're going to be doing a custom coop for him.
It's exciting.
That is very exciting. So thank you so much for taking the time to come down here. And going on that trip. And that is why I emphasize, you know, this is just these opportunities, these moments that just people dream of. And we're so lucky that we get to live them. And I doubt you'll ever forget that for the rest of your life.
Oh, there's no way.
So are you hooked?
Are you ready
for your next step?
Yeah, why not?
Let's go. Mackenzie has asked if she can help with sales, be part of sales, do sales. Kristen last week said, Matt, we need more people. We're not even in our busy season, and thank God we're as busy as we are. But it's a lot of work. You got the phone calls, you got the emails, texts, peer chat, dealing with me. So Mackenzie, we've asked you before if you wanted to do sales
for like 2.5 whole years.
Right, and I tell you what you do is awesome, and I don't want to ruin a good thing. But I'm curious, you know, what our audience thinks. Should Mackenzie come and also be an additional saleswoman for Carolina Coops? You have chickens.
I do.
You love
pickles
animals.
And bologna.
Right.
And the other and others.
So on a percentage, how close are we to you saying, you know what? I think I want to do this. I want to do sales. See, I'm putting you on the spot.
I don't know. I will do whatever. If somebody needs help, I'll help, whatever. But it's going to be a process. I can do it. I will do it. I think it would be. I take that last statement back. We'll talk about it.
We have our meeting today with Mackenzie. We have one-on-ones, everyone. And this is where we ask them, what do you love? What do you hate? What do we got to do? All that good stuff, which I think most companies do anyways. So yeah. I am just so happy to hear that you're considering doing sales. I think you and Kristen would do a phenomenal job. Especially one loves being on the phone. One loves doing emails. I mean, they all get kind of old after a while. But I appreciate everything you do. You are, you don't hear the things I say. You're a badass. You're loyal. We trust you. Our customers love you.
My face is hot.
Okay. I mean it. And I tell you, I was so happy to share with you and Evan, and I try to share it with everyone.
My first Chick-fil-A experience.
Oh, I know. We had a great Chick-fil-A experience.
I love fried chicken. I love food. I just love food. Pickles.
Yes. Who doesn't love Chick-fil-A?
Not the chicken. Pickles. Pickles on a chicken sandwich.
Not your pickles.
Right.
Right.
Oh, and I hear you have a 1 o'clock pedicure. So thank you.
Oh,
for,
yeah.
Yes. So
that's my first pedicure, too. Look at so many firsts.
Yes. And then we got our meeting this afternoon. All right. So we're going to press on. Mackenzie, thank you so much.
You're
I can't
welcome.
Wait to talk to you later.
Bye, guys.
That is Mackenzie, everyone here in North Carolina, not up in New York. I am trying to suck her in to love North Carolina so she will move down here. And hopefully make things easier. But anyways, all right, so that was Mackenzie. It is 12:14. I think that was fun.
Yes.
How did you, I mean, do you remember when he goes, you know, tomorrow's not promised?
Yeah. Oh, he was totally cool. Just totally cool. Like, I if I didn't know ahead of time he was some special celebrity, I would have just said, oh, that's a very normal chicken customer that's excited about having chickens.
Yeah.
Because one of his friends has chickens and he just didn't know how good the eggs were. Right? I mean, how often have we heard that?
I know. I mean, here he said the things that we always hear. It's like once you had a fresh egg.
Right.
And if you're listening right now and you've never had a fresh egg.
Right.
True from the back. We're not talking about store-bought, cage-free, pasture-raised, whatever. Yeah.
He was totally into it.
Yes.
And then I said, well, you know, a lot of people get into chickens because of the eggs. And then they end up realizing all of the other benefits of having chickens and how much you love these little creatures and how personable they are and how therapeutic they are. And he was like, wow, yeah, I can see that.
Yeah. So
totally normal.
Doesn't matter how totally normal rich guy. And famous you are. At the end of the day, we all love eggs.
Right. And it's like our guest last week who said chickens are what unites all of us as people.
And it's in our DNA. Right.
It's in our DNA.
And yeah, that was awesome.
Common denominator.
Yes. Right.
Taking care of chickens.
So,
and that last week was Portlandia.
Chickenlandia.
Chickenlandia. Sorry, but
I know we've had a long week. Also, just to share with everyone some other things that happened this week. We had our first heart attack. Poor AV.
I ran into a fence post chasing a chicken and another staff member had a heart attack.
Yeah, we almost lost an employee this week.
It's really going to be hard to recruit from now on.
You want to talk about tomorrow?
Yeah, really. I don't know why.
Yeah.
This is not a good recruiting tool at
all. The show really became a real downer.
Yeah, AV and
our he's fine.
Yes.
He's fine. He had previous heart problems, right?
Yeah, and he had a heart attack right here. They're getting ready to leave to go on a turnkey.
Mm-hmm.
And Sean calls me up. Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to get into detail. Prayers and thoughts for AV. They took him to the hospital. They let him go. We sent him up to New York. He's going to meet with his doctor and go under the knife, have surgery. And things will turn out well for him. He's a big, strong guy. It's just scary.
I know.
Just like that. And it scared him. It scared him, which is good, I think. I think sometimes we kind of have to have that.
Yeah, we have to remember to take care of ourselves. That's why we say take care of your chickens and yourself.
Yeah, exactly. Right? So, yeah, just crazy stuff.
Where would our chickens be if we couldn't go out and buy them food and bring them water and stuff like that? You know, like they kind of need us. They only need us like
chase them out of a tree.
Yeah. They only need us once a week or so, but really.
All right, so let's get into the chickens. We're going to talk about chicken breeds. So what we would love, you know, if you have any questions, again, this show is for you guys. If you have any questions, leave them in the comments. And if you don't have any questions.
Are we really going to talk about chicken breeds today?
We're talking about chicken breeds.
You know what I think about that?
Well, I do.
Wait, this is a setup.
No, it's not a setup. But I'll tell you, a question I get a lot that I love this question. And they ask me, Matt, what's your favorite breeds?
Mm-hmm.
And we get that question a lot in general. What chicken should I get? I've read this. I've read that. So what I really want to emphasize to everyone, especially if you're on the fence and you're thinking about getting into chickens, and I worry when people read something we know that's just not true. And we talked about that last week, that it's not that complicated. There's bad information out there, but understand why. And something that does frustrate me, and I know it frustrates you, is people are like, well, I've read this and I've read that, so this is the type of breed I should have. So I want to make sure we talk about that today. But at the end of the day, we have to pick out some breeds.
And there are certain things that are certain breed characteristics. Certain characteristics associated with certain breeds. Certain breeds are bred for different things, whether it's egg production, whether it's calm personalities, whatever. Mm-hmm. Correct?
Aren't they all?
Thank you.
No, not all of them are bred for egg production. Mm. For a lot of egg production.
Mm. This is gonna be tough for us to make. I already feel it. No, so Ingrid's exactly right. You know, there are breeds, and there's a lot of chickens that have been bred, you know, in different parts of the world here in America to be an egg producer, to be a meat chicken. That is absolutely true. What I want to emphasize is, as much as that is true, I feel this is just like any pet. It's in how you raise them.
Definitely.
And when you're raising them.
Same with children.
Yes, it's the same thing. So, you know, and I brought this out. I wanted, because, you know, chick season's right around the corner. Think about it. I mean, January, February is around the corner.
Place your orders now.
Place your orders now. Now, for the record, the only people paying for this show right now is Carolina Coops. We do not get paid by some of the companies we promote. I am proud to say that because I love to promote and not, you know, the things I believe in because I want to share good information. So there are hatcheries. A lot of people don't realize you can buy chickens online.
Oh, yeah.
And they come in the mail. Mm-hmm. And the restrictions on that have kind of come down a little bit, or even state regulations in some areas. There's it's different for a lot of different areas where you have to order a minimum six, or you go into your tractor supply store or whatever, your agricultural store, and then you have to buy a minimum of six. Sometimes there's three. But there's been companies now that are able to ship adult chickens successfully. You know, there's a risk, obviously. But that's just something that you have to understand. You can go order chickens online, mm-hmm. but if you are thinking about doing that, place your order soon. And then there are challenges, like, are they all going to, the breeds you want to get, are they going to hatch at the same time?
Yeah, because there is a window. You can raise chicks successfully that are a week apart, maybe even 2 weeks apart, if they're in a small batch.
Well, and also the thing that allows them to be able to ship successfully is when they're born, they have the nutrients from still developing in the egg where they don't have to eat.
Right.
For, I think it was 24, 48 hours.
Yeah, 2 days, they're fine in the mail. 3 days, that's
the nightmare that happened last year.
You're going to have some losses.
I had a friend of mine who works for the post office, and she was sending me, can I say post office?
Yes, you can say post office. Good thing.
I just want to make sure. The amount of chickens they killed was insane. She was sending me pictures.
Yeah, I've heard of just complete losses right and left because of COVID delays and people not being at work.
Right. So let me be clear. I have ordered a lot of baby chicks through the mail. And I think maybe one or two were DOA.
Yeah.
Which I think is a great rate.
Right.
And there's huge advantages to be able to order because you can find maybe a specific breed you want.
Oh, the selection is wonderful.
The selection is wonderful. Right. But what? Why? Why are we going to choose the breed we want? Even my dad yesterday goes, you know, he's watching me, right? I did a little pregame. I'm going to share something with you guys. Are we ready to get started?
Sure.
So I'm gonna do something here. You don't know about this. So Kristen doesn't know what I'm about to do. And we will get to your questions and comments. I definitely appreciate them down below. But we're going to have a little fun here. All right. So we're going to do something new. Huh? So I get asked a lot, what's my favorite breeds?
Yeah.
And one time we had another, A-list, thank you, A-list customer. And he asked me, he goes, what are your top 25? That's what I'm going to get. I'm like, okay. But let me be clear. When it comes to thinking about what chicken breeds do I want to get, yes, you want to think about, do I want a good egg layer? Do I got to worry about cold? Do I got to worry about heat? All the time worry that it's like that's the wrong thing to look at. I say it's like picking out clothes. What do you want to wear? What's your favorite color? Because at the end of the day, it's going to come down to how you're raising them and why it's so important to have the right size chicken coop and all that good stuff. That there are maybe a couple breeds I would say absolutely stay away from. All right. So I wanted to get into Matt's favorite chicken breeds.
Okay.
And also Ingrid will be able to use this video down the road. So when people do ask for that, we don't just have to send them a spreadsheet.
All right.
They're going to have a video. Are you ready?
We're ready.
We're ready. Okay. So let me be clear. This is just my personal preference, and it is 95% just because of how they look.
Okay.
I'm being very judgmental. We're going to go backwards. We're going to start at number 25.
Aww.
And I'm going to put you on the spot. You ready?
Yes.
And I bet you I'm going to give you, you'll pass with flying colors.
What?
That's why I took away your cheat sheet. What do we have in front of us?
It's a Japanese bantam.
That is a Japanese bantam. And do you believe bantam made my top 25?
Yeah, I'm surprised. It is on the bottom of the list. So I don't know how much credit you get for that.
So this is the black-tailed white Japanese.
Mm-hmm.
Now, notice... And I stole pictures off the internet. Some people might get credit, doesn't it? Whatever. I did include the rooster on this one. Because I tell you what. When I had a black-tailed white Japanese. Can we get Gus out of here, please? I need Gus out of here and the door shut, please. All right. Sorry about that. I know he cat people. Gosh, we can't just all get along.
No, he's fine as long as he doesn't get me wet.
All right, so black-tailed white Japanese. I tell you, beautiful chicken, especially the rooster. And I know a lot of bantams. Here they all come. Oh, come on.
The door doesn't shut because the cord.
You got to move the cord over. Sorry.
I tried that earlier.
What a great little chicken. What a great little chicken. And then here's the other thing I want to explain. Like, my favorite breeds, I'm very biased towards black and white.
Yeah, that was obvious from your list.
I was like, yeah.
Yeah, we all have our preferences. I love the spotted ones.
Oh, I'm glad you mentioned spotted ones.
I love those.
So here's the thing, and here's why I wanted to do this list. So many people, even again, my dad yesterday goes, oh, I didn't know there's so many breeds. When we did that site survey, mm-hmm. he goes, how many, is there, there's 25 breeds? We're like, God, there's hundreds of breeds. Yeah. And there seems like there's new breeds coming out, you know, especially, I'll never forget, 2 years ago when we got baby chicks, Jetta had to get the calico princess or whatever just because it says princess. So blacktail white, Japanese, beautiful little bantam. Are we ready for number 24? You're going to love number 24.
Oh, yes. Yes, I love those.
I want to say
those are Americanas for all those podcast listeners.
Yes.
Or the Easter egger.
Yes, you are correct, Americana. Mm-hmm. Now, a lot of people don't know there's not just white and brown eggs. And here's a great example, and there's why I included the color of the eggs on this one. The turquoise, the blue, sometimes mm-hmm. pink. And you can have so many different color variations to the Americana. Mm-hmm. I think this is a lavender. I love like that color.
Yeah. If I could have one chicken, or if I was limited to one chicken, it would be the Americana because of the variety.
The variety in the eggs,
the variety in the feather color, and the puffy cheeks, the bearded, the small comb. A lot of families like the Americana. They're drawn to that one because it has a small comb and it doesn't look roosterish. You know, a lot of these female hens still have the large single comb, and that turns people off. It reminds them of a rooster. Whereas with the Americana, their combs are largely hidden and very small, and their wattles are usually hidden,
mm-hmm.
and their earlobes are white. So they have a much friendlier appearance, I think, because of both the puffiness in the face and because it doesn't recall that fear that a lot of people actually have. They have some experience in their past. Like, I was attacked by a rooster when I was a kid. So that's why I don't like chickens. I've heard that many times.
Oh, yeah. We hear it all the time.
Yeah. So that's why I think the Americana is a win.
Excellent. Thank you.
Also,
this is going to be fun.
Also, just for being technical, the Americanas, a lot of times the Easter eggers are bred or a mutt of an Americana. So Americana gets you the gene for the blue or green egg, correct? And then they're a lot of times, so you'll see ones that look very different, and they would be like an Easter egger, which isn't a true Americana. So there's the breed, and then there's the line.
Different strain, yes.
Yeah.
So
people use those terms interchangeably.
Right.
Americana and Easter egger.
Right.
But technically, they're not the same.
And I know the Americana people out there that love them to death, they get real offended by that. They're like, that's not an Americana.
Oh, yeah. And here's a little tip. When your farm store has the Easter eggers or Americanas in the farm store, be the first one in line, because out of the box, you get to pick out all the different ones, which I'll usually get a white one and a tan one and a brown one and a gray one, because they come in all those different colors.
Mm-hmm.
And Mount Healthy Hatchery seems to have the most variety.
Oh, yeah. And I was going to plug a couple hatcheries. We're going to talk about that as we get through this list.
Whereas, you know, like Whelp, at least in years past, all of those look the same. They're the brown ones.
Love Whelp. We're going to talk about Whelp here in a little bit. Here's a slightly unique one.
Yeah, I never heard of it.
And unique for me, but I love when there's just little hints of color here and there. And it really goes against what I really love in chickens, which we're going to talk about that when we get to
That's a hen, but it looks roosterish.
That is true.
Right? So some people are going to be turned off by that.
So this is a tough one. Any guesses on this breed?
It looks leghornish, but it's one of those new ones. Isn't it Arcana? California white.
California white. Huh? California being represented. Ingrid shaking no.
I just never heard of it.
Yeah, I haven't either.
I haven't heard that either.
I came across them. I love.
Wait, that got a higher position than the Japanese bantam?
This is going to be a long list.
This is going to take forever. And I'm going to end up strangling you by the end.
I am a little worried.
Oh,
but
my goodness.
The point is,
I think I already know what number one is.
I bet you don't. I tell you what, do me a favor.
I think people should guess. I wanted to say that if people could guess in the comments what they think Matt's number one breed is.
Favorite breed. Write it down somewhere. Don't show anyone. For the record.
Well, if we're all guessing.
No. Write it. Because
I want people to guess.
Yes. I don't. Because if you're right, I don't want to ruin. I don't want to see it either. I want to see. Thank you. Make sure. Okay. Those are last week's notes. California White. I don't know anything about them. But they're just beautiful. I love that look. But, you know, that's a great point. They are roosterish. And here's the other thing we have noticed over the years. You know, I wanted to talk real quick about some breeds I would avoid. And one of the things we've realized, you know, the Lakenvelder. Crazy chicken.
Yeah. Was that a bad batch or are they always like that?
I don't know. But I've noticed chickens that have really large tails like the California White tend to be flighty. I don't know if I'm right or wrong. I would love to know if anybody else has any California.
That's clearly bred from a Leghorn.
Kim Daly says she has a California White and she loves her.
See? Nice.
I think it's all about how you raise them. I've had really nice Leghorns. Like a brown Leghorn, and then there's a black spotted Leghorn, I think. Which I
Ruby. What was that?
I like Foghorn Leghorn.
Aww. So that's a Welsummer?
Very good. This is a Welsummer. Now, I love Welsummers because they are just beautiful. They have a certain feather pattern that I can't remember off the top of my head. I'm sure you know. I don't know if it was penciling.
Penciled.
It's just absolutely gorgeous. But one of my favorite things to do when we do shows or we do classes with the kids, we bring in the Welsummer egg.
Yeah.
And it's spotted.
Yeah. I would say that I'm not such a fan of how that one looks, but I am a fan of the eggs.
Okay.
I got a Welsummer.
Now, Welsummer.
Kristen.
Wonder why.
And she's super flighty.
Really? Yeah. Oh, boy, that kind of makes sense.
I didn't do it.
So the point here, this is why I included the egg color, is after you get into backyard chickens, and everyone's like, well, I just want the eggs. And then you find out how good the eggs are. Then you find out about the other breeds.
Yeah.
And then you find out how many different colored eggs there are.
Right.
And then you find out from listening to Matt and Kirsten at Carolina Coops that they say, wait a minute, I don't have to refrigerate them. I could put them out in a big bowl on my dining room table, like a fruit basket. And not only do you have colors, but you're going to have the speckles.
Right.
So just that's one of the things I love about the Welsummer is more the egg than, but it is a beautiful hen.
Yeah. I will usually, when I do a starter flock, I'll usually add a Welsummer just for the egg.
So this one's kind of a tough one, but again, I am very fond of the black and white chickens, but we want to focus on that. It's like, people that love Labradors.
Yeah.
There's yellow labs, chocolate labs, black labs. So that's going to be kind of a thing here.
Is that a Colombian or a Wyandotte?
So I always think about it as a Colombian, and this one in particular.
Colombian Wyandotte.
Is a Colombian Wyandotte. But there are other breeds that look so similar.
Right.
But what told you that was a Colombian Wyandotte? What are we looking at?
It would be the comb.
The comb. Isn't that incredible? How that just gives it away.
And the body shape. I mean, it's fat and fluffy.
Yeah, so that's why I love Wyandottes. I love the fat and fluffy chickens. That's why I was surprised about the California White. But the black and white, especially when it's...
Yeah, I don't think you're honest on this ranking. That Colombian White should not have been in that position, based on what I know about you. But go ahead.
Wait a minute, the California White?
Yeah.
Oh, love them.
So...
That looks like a buff Brahma.
Yay! We might, I tell you, you're doing pretty good. You're doing pretty good. Okay. That is a buff Brahma. What gave it away that is a buff Brahma?
The feathered feet and the comb.
Yes, the boot. Oh, and the comb again, in the booting.
So, and the color.
I tell you, last night, we're all getting ready to go out for tacos, and we're pretty
thanks well for the invite.
Schnickered. Well, I'm sure you were busy running into fences and whatnot. Mackenzie goes, you told me Brahmas aren't booted. I was like, no, they're booted. That's kind of one of the giveaways. Mm-hmm. So she swears up and down at one point when we were doing, you know, questions from New York or whatever, that she was all upset. She went running home thinking she didn't have a Brahma. So I don't know. Maybe we need to look that up, find out if that was true.
I looked it back up on the video, but I can't remember what it was now.
So Brahmas in general, you have all kinds of different Brahmas. I love the buff. And
that's my least favorite because it's skin colored. Like, I don't want my chicken having the same color skin as me.
They're just so, that's such a
I don't
nice...
know. I don't like my walls like having the same skin color as me too. Like,
so.
Here or my car seats. Like, some cars have that leather color that's the same color as me. I don't want that. I don't want to blend in with my seat color.
So here we have another breed. It looks just like the Colombian Wyandotte, but it's not.
Yeah, so that's a light Brahma.
Are you cheating?
No. These are easy.
Okay.
Well, I didn't get the Columbia White, but that was like a made up breed. Someone made that up in the last year.
You mean California?
Yeah, yeah. Sorry.
I was just gonna say. What did I say? Columbian White.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I can tell you're getting a little angry. You're trying to stay calm and
yeah,
nice.
Yeah, I know. I'm like really probably shaking here, with anticipation.
The light Brahma. Again, Brahmas in general, fat.
Yeah.
Booted chickens.
And they are one of the largest or the largest breed of chickens.
Absolutely. Now, what are some of the advantages? Why are they booted?
Why are they booted? Well, I don't know, because they look cool. I mean, genetically, I'm not sure why.
I have been told that it's to help protect their feet.
To keep them warm so they in can colder be climates. In,
to keep them that warm in colder climates.
But they can be a little more difficult to deal with if you have any scaly leg.
That's a good
because
point.
Because it's very hard to treat.
Yeah.
Once they get it.
That's a great point. Love it. Moving on.
Oh, no. Yes. Now, I love, that's one of my favorite feather patterns because it's like a stormy night. It's a black sky with little stars all over. And if I can, is that a leghorn, the Excalitor, or is that the Arcana? No, the. I'm sorry, I don't remember how to pronounce all these.
This is not easy. You're doing great. I tell
was
you.
Was it one of those two?
Your description of.
The Anokana.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I'll give it to you.
It was like a blue.
Love these.
Yes.
And I never thought of it as like a starry night.
Yeah.
I mean, that's pretty poetic and whatnot. But that's the beauty of chickens is you have all these different breeds. Right. And why am I going to choose this?
Yeah. You know? I love that one.
Yeah. That's all I know about
I'm
the
getting kind of goosebumps. So it has, I don't have one of those right now.
Now, can we assume that it lays white eggs?
Making notes. Yes.
Why?
Because it looks like a leghorn. It was probably descended from the leghorn.
What about its earlobe?
And its earlobe.
Thank you. Earlobes. Notice, can I? The camera's probably going
to
cut it off.
So, yeah, if you're going to have a leghorn, why wouldn't you get that? Like, why? Why would you get one of the ugly white ones? Like, why?
Absolutely beautiful chicken. All right, now, I tell you, we're only at 17. We're getting.
That's
getting
an Orpington. Lavender Orpington?
So, I tell you, this one threw me for a...
Or is it this? Look, the comb looks a little rose.
I actually never heard of this breed before.
Oh, another made-up breed.
It comes from a common.
It does have a rose comb, so it's not a blue Wyandotte. Okay, so yeah, I could have guessed that.
Yeah, I would have never known because it looks like a regular. Right. Well, you can't really see it.
But the body shape certainly looks like an Orpington.
Yes. Very fluffy.
Yeah.
But a blue Wyandotte.
Orpingtons technically are loosely feathered, which I just laugh because, you know, some people say, I'm not heavy, I'm just loosely feathered.
That's another good t-shirt, like bantams don't count. All right, so here's a breed. Oh,
black-faced Spanish? I mean, white-faced Spanish? Black Spanish.
You're on the right track.
Black, white-faced.
She just doesn't get the right order.
White-faced black Spanish.
Exactly.
Okay.
I would have never picked these out of a book.
Yeah, why in the world would you pick that, though, for one of your, for number 16?
Because they're beautiful. And this
they're
is not
a little freaky like clowns.
Well, some people might like them because
of mimes. They look like
I don't know.
I mean, if you saw that in a dark alley, like you can't tell me that you would get really, really nervous. Especially if it was like people size.
We had to get these for a customer. I don't know what's going on right now, folks. I apologize.
They're getting
a little
I'm
goofy.
Just I just want to clarify. So if you saw another chicken that was human size, it wouldn't be scary. Just this one. Just wondering.
I was just trying to make it like build it up into something more scary than just running into a chicken in an alley. Just
walking around with a little balloon.
Yes.
Come here, kid. So
like a clown collar on that in a dark alley. A rubber nose.
What is going on with you guys today? I would have never picked these out.
Yeah, and you never will. Let's go on to number 15.
No, we did. You did. That is not true. We had to for a customer.
Now, let's go on to number 15. We got to speed this up.
I think we're doing quite well.
Yeah, when are we going to go over my list?
These chickens in real life are stunning.
Yeah.
No, whatever. You disagree?
No, okay, let's go on. Wow. Oh, see, you've got the black chicken with the white spots. I love that one.
And? What kind?
Oh, that's a Cochin, modeled Cochin. Modeled Java.
Pretty good. I'll give it to you.
It looks more Cochin-ish. The Javas typically look more like a Leghorn.
And you got to remember, I'm trusting Google, but I see the modeling. Mm. Is that the right way to put it? Where the feathers? And there's even ones that have less of the white. I just was trying to find a good picture of it, but the modeled Java, absolutely think they're gorgeous. Yeah. It's a beautiful chicken. But other than that, I don't know anything else about them. I don't know what color egg they lay, but they're just beautiful. Mm-hmm. If anybody has any modeled Java, have you ever had any?
Well, I'm making a note. I'm making a shopping list. I know what I'm going to do on vacation. Just ignore that comment, Dale.
So we all know this one. This is just kind of a go-to.
Oh, golden laced or gold-laced Wyandotte.
Yep. Because your spelling's terrible.
Yes, that's awful.
Yeah, you got laced wrong and Wyandotte wrong, but whatever.
Listen.
Yeah, this list is going downhill fast.
I was never an A-plus student. My dad is behind me while I'm doing this last night, just like, come on, time to go get tacos.
Okay.
So I typed real fast. I apologize. Do I get a B at least so far?
Let's keep going. Let's see how this
ends up. Effort.
All right.
It's the goth chicken.
These things are lovely.
I don't know. I've had these and I don't really understand all the hype. I mean, they're cool. Maybe you could have one, but I've never, all of mine were really, really like, impersonable and flighty. I don't know. What, Ingrid, what do you think?
Yeah, they're a little feral.
Yeah, a little feral is exactly right. Like,
you know, no one has a perfect family. All right.
They are beautiful.
They are
cool, but like I would not want a flock of these.
How do you pronounce the name?
Armenciani.
I say
Samani.
I am Samani.
Yeah.
I am Samani.
I just call him the goth chicken.
The all black chicken. Mm-hmm. The meat is black.
The meat is not black.
I read the meat is black.
No.
They also say the eggs are black.
You're telling me that's not true. I know the eggs are not black. I thought the meat was black.
No. The bones are black.
Is that what it is? The bones are black?
The silky has black meat. But yeah.
These are cool chickens, and we're seeing them more and more. They're
not as people used to say you could get $700 for a hen for these, but they're much more common now, so the prices come way down on them.
So this was going to be my first chicken when I was chicken shopping.
I do like the barred, the stripes.
These are great chickens.
Plymouth barred rock.
Love.
Yes, and you can see all sorts of variety and personality with these, and they're great layers.
Yes.
All around great bird.
So I want to let people know, if you're starting out, you, in my opinion, with the right coop, you really can almost get any chicken you want. All right. But we're just going to, I want to emphasize.
You really can get any chicken that you want.
I want to emphasize.
Don't let Matt hold you back.
I want to emphasize.
Don't limit people.
I want to emphasize there's so many different varieties, and why not get, again, it's like, what do you do? How do you pick out shoes at a shoe store? You know, you get what looks good to you. And there's going to be little differences between this one, you are correct, the barred rock, versus there's a couple other breeds that look just like it. Cucumeran did not make my cut. And the Dominique. Right.
Yep. But the Dominique has a different comb.
A peak comb.
Yep.
So I just think that's awesome.
Yeah.
The barred rocks are amazing, though. They're chatty. I had two of the same clutch, and they were very different, and they're just great chicken. They're just a great basic chicken.
They are.
I would highly recommend them.
So if you are thinking about, you know, what's some good breeds all around that I should maybe start off with if you're really worried about whatever it is, you know, something you read online, a barred rock is just a great chicken.
Oh, and I see Happy Wife just commented that her barred rock is the sweetest out of her flock.
Yeah, I can't wait to get to the comments.
Yeah.
So
I just spotted that.
We're halfway through. We're halfway through the list already. Oh, we're only halfway through. Okay, come on. This is awesome. Okay. Now it's getting real.
All right. The silver laced Wyandotte.
Yeah.
Wow.
Love the silver laced Wyandotte.
And those are very cost effective chickens. Like a lot. Most of these are just run of the mill hatchery or very common affordable chickens. Like you can get these at the farm store in the spring for $5.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe.
Again, it's another.
So these so it's just amazing for a basic laying backyard chicken. It they come that beautiful.
Yes.
Like you don't have to pay extra for that. That's just, you know, like an average chicken.
Right.
And why wouldn't you?
Right. And you have different kinds of Wyandottes, again, just like Labradors. And I have a preference for the black and white. I just absolutely love that. Mm-hmm. So the silver lace is why it's up higher on the list.
Right.
Just absolutely gorgeous. Great, great chicken. Oh, yes, and you got it correct. Good job.
And still the spelling.
All right. Another great.
Just taking a closer look. That's all.
Well, this one, I picked out this picture because I tell you, again, loosely feathered.
This doesn't look like.
Yeah, the head looks a little weird, but. Yeah.
I think they might be a little young. I noticed that. There could have been some photoshopping. But
they look a little fuzzy in the face, but is that a Orpington?
That is an Orpington.
Is they call it a buff or?
Oh, come on. Now you're just trying. Okay. Buff Orpington, another goat.
That looks like more of the English version, though.
Yeah.
Can I show you an English version?
Yes.
You and Ingrid didn't talk about this already.
No.
So I mentioned this before, and I wish we could hunt this lady down, get her selling chickens again. Hickory Chickory in North Carolina, probably in Hickory, North Carolina. I will never forget one of our, 2014, we're going back to 2014, doing a custom coop, and she had a Buff Orpington. You know, I'm going to wait. I want to show you something because she had the English and it was incredible how much bigger and just so beautiful.
Even more loosely feathered.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. But great, great chicken. Buff Orpington. Very common, but just a good chicken to have in your flock.
They always say they're good with children because they're very docile.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they can be very docile. But I hear that about the Rhode Island Red. Every Rhode Island Red I've had.
No, the Rhode Island Red is just a huge variety in personality. I mean,
mine was great.
Yeah. They can be wonderful or a little, I don't know.
So number nine.
That looks like a frizzled.
And I couldn't.
Frizzled. The black one looks like a frizzled Cochin bantam. And the one on the right.
So it's black and white frizzled. And it could something. Be a Cochin. And
okay. The one on the right's not a Cochin. Because it doesn't have feathered feet.
Right. But it's a bantam frizzle. And I just wanted one. I love them. And you know I'm not a huge fan of bantams.
I don't know what's wrong with you. Like, I should storm off the set right now.
It's just me. But I love, if I'm going to have a couple bantams.
But it did make number nine, so I appreciate number nine. That.
You're welcome. Love these. We've had them. Just beautiful chickens. What's interesting is the reverse feathered, to give them that frizzle. I believe, if I remember correctly, you said that's a genetic defect that they try to reproduce.
It's recessive.
Recessive.
I believe it's recessive.
But you can
actually. That's why you don't get out of a batch of, if you order from a hatchery, I believe they'll send you a batch of chickens and, well, out of the frizzles, it doesn't breed true.
It's not a guarantee you're going to have a frizzle.
And same with the blue color is not a true, it's not a guarantee. So if you order something blue, sometimes you'll get black and white and blue.
So, and I love this picture. I couldn't decide white or black, so since I'm a fan of black. And plus, you said last week bantams don't count, so.
No.
Is there a disadvantage to the frizzled feathers? Is there something that, is that good or bad or?
Well, their flight can be hindered by that, and also, which could be a good or bad thing. They may have a little harder time getting to a roost, but I have a frizzle that has no trouble. And maybe keeping warm. But that would be only in extreme temperatures.
Okay.
Good point. Good point. Great question. All right, moving on. So, yeah, black and white frizzle.
No, I see booted feet on that one.
Mm-hmm.
So, is that a golden laced Cochin?
See, you're just, you're trying to be modest. I love it. So now I love the Cochins. It's golden laced. It's got the feathering. Oh, no. Whoa.
Yeah.
Whoa, that's an error. No, you are correct.
Yeah.
Oh, what happened?
Oh, look at that. I'm right.
It's supposed to be a Cochin.
It's supposed to be a Cochin. Who made this spreadsheet?
Yes.
Who
you did were this? Thinking about tacos at this point.
Oh,
you're
my
like,
goodness.
Yeah. No. That margarita at and that taco.
At this point, Jetta, my daughter's bringing in Bud Light popsicles. Anyways.
Okay.
You are correct. I was just trying to throw you a curveball. I just wanted to see how close you're paying attention. This is the Golden Lace Cochin. Yes. And fat. Big booted. Love it. Absolutely gorgeous. Number eight. All right. So we're getting up there.
Yes.
we're getting up there. Do we have any questions before we go any further? Some comments? We've kind of haven't, you know.
Well, people are just commenting with their chickens. Like Lisa Haymaker said, the Buff Orpington was her friendliest, most loyalist, and best egg producer from all her original flock. They are. They're great chickens.
Yeah, the they Buff really Orpingtons. Are. They really are. All right, so moving on. So we are into the top 10.
Okay, I'm
slowly
ready.
Slowly getting up I'm there. Ready. You've done pretty good.
I'm ready.
You've done really. I don't think you've missed one yet, technically.
Well, the California white.
And I'll be on. Yeah. Well, again, that's an oddball. I'll give you a handicap. All right, so now I'm going to be
blue
honest.
Blue lace, red Wyandotte?
I'll be honest with you. Here's where it gets tough for me. Because once we get to the blue lace, red Wyandotte, you have to ask yourself, when people are like, Matt, you got to put an order. If you can only have one chicken for the rest of your life, what would it be? And I tell you, this is one that is, I just love them. This, I wish was my number one, to be honest with you. Love the blue lace red
if you wished it was your number one. I wonder who created the list.
it's I did,
like, I wonder how. Oh,
I did. It's tough. Mm-hmm. Here's where you really got to go, crap, I didn't know there's so many breeds and I'm only allowed to have six. How are you gonna pick six?
This is a great slideshow.
Thank you. I worked very hard on it. Blue lace red Wyandotte. Again, another Wyandotte, beautiful feather pattern, and I found some great pictures.
Yeah.
And I tell you, pictures really never do them justice, but they are just...
Those are beautiful.
Absolutely a gorgeous chicken. All right, number six, and this is going to come at no surprise.
Blue Cochin?
So, Orpington, blue Orpington, and I know I said the same thing every time I saw that picture. And
yeah, I can't see his feet. Just to be fair,
mm-hmm. I absolutely. But I love the blues, and you can have the Orpingtons and the Cochins, and of course you have the blue.
Mm-hmm.
Would it be considered a lavender Orpington or a blue? Is there a difference between lavender and blue?
There is. I'm not sure what it is. It's just a slight variation.
So blue is darker than the lavender.
I believe so.
I think so. I think lavender is going to be a little bit lighter. I do like the lavenders, but they didn't obviously make the list yet.
Okay.
But.
That's the blue Cochin.
This is the blue Cochin.
That was my guess.
Really?
Yes. For your number one, I thought it was going to be the blue Cochin.
I tell you, from the top five up.
Or I said Cochin, but it still could be right.
Love the Cochins. And we got some great pictures. If I had more time, I wanted to bring up videos where you've raised Cochins.
Yeah, I'm going to get one of those. Let me have the pen.
Being,
I'm making my list. Yeah, I'm definitely going to get a blue Cochin this year.
Love the Cochins. Again, they just look like little fullbacks, little linebackers, big, fat, fluffy, and they're booted. And these are just, you know, just a great example. Just
and the ones you get at the hatchery look just like that. The farm store ones that I've gotten.
True, but I wanted to talk about that because that has a little bit of why I picked my number one.
Okay, let's see it.
You getting excited?
Yeah.
Okay. So you can get number one, blue Cochin. All right, going on to number four. Now, this chicken is awesome.
I have a lot of those right now.
And I'm not in love with how she looks.
Well, that's a good thing because there's no standard.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah, it's not a real breed.
We're talking about the olive egger.
That is correct. This is the olive
and
egger.
That's why you had to show a picture of the eggs in order to identify that bird, because olive eggers look like all kinds of different birds.
Right, and my olive egger actually looked a lot like her, so I was like, okay.
And I have a lot of olive eggers because I formerly had a black copper maron rooster. So I was just hatching out all of the blue eggs and all of the...
But all of
those chickens ended up being olive eggers.
And was it true that to get the olive egg, they took an Americana and bred with a black copper maron?
Yes, that's what I was doing.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's awesome. And
now those are the generation that are laying right now.
Beautiful, beautiful eggs. I love that 70s green.
Yeah, if you noticed, I brought eggs to the celebrity yesterday, day before.
Yeah, it's all blurred now.
Yes, and a bunch of them were olive, right?
Yes, and they're just... beautiful. And he was so happy.
Yeah.
He was so happy. That's always a nice touch. So the olive egger, number four.
Interesting.
More because of the egg. All right. We're into the top three. Are you ready?
Right.
Any guesses yet? You want a second chance at number one, number two, number three?
I think one of those is going to be the black copper maron.
There it is. This is the French black copper maron. Love this breed. And their biggest reason is they are beautiful. They are, you know, a beautiful hen, but more importantly, their eggs are so dark.
Right.
And again.
Can be.
Can be. That is true.
Because mine is not.
Right. There can be some that are kind of like, okay. But I've seen them, you know, and you can go online and Google it and the different variations of how dark they are. But I love that you can have, you know, you got your regular brown egg, regular white egg, and then of course you got your turquoise, which are cool, you know. So, okay, I got some Americanos. But then you get into the olive eggers and the French Capemaran. This is when people, when you have that egg basket and you got all these different colors, just absolutely.
I was rocking some really good egg baskets last summer.
Thanks a lot, Dale. French Black Capemaran. Absolutely love it. And there is another breed that will lay a very dark egg that we talked about. The cuckoo.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not a huge fan of the cuckoo marron because I feel like for having the ability to lay such a dark colored egg, they should be a little bit more colorful, separate themselves from the barred rock.
The cuckoo marron from lots of different places, and I've never had a dark egg out of what was sold as a. And those are all hatchery, or, you know, these aren't just backyard people, but like they never actually end up with a dark egg. So don't get your hopes up if you're buying one of those.
Number two.
Looks like a speckled Sussex, but the body shape doesn't. Wow. Is that like a... It looks like the body shape of a cochin. Does it have feathered feet?
Ingrid, where is our video?
I think it's in...
Is it...
New scene.
Oh, it's right there. Mm-hmm. So, and...
And I do love that. I do love the spots.
This is a great chicken.
You know this one. And I'll never forget when you taught me something about this breed. I'll never forget. And it's one of the reasons why I really like it.
Is it speckled Sussex?
Mm-mm.
Huh. A Jubilee Orpington. Yes. I forgot about those.
Yes. So what is a fun fact about Jubilees? And I bet you this is probably maybe true with the mottled and a couple other breeds. But I thought this was fun, and I want to make sure people hear this because I never realized this, but this makes it...
Look at my shirt! I just realized it's just like my favorite chicken. Black with white spots.
Okay. You scared me for a minute.
I was just realizing, wow.
That is true.
That is not even planned.
Subconsciously,
wow.
Yeah, subconsciously you probably do.
Wow, I look like my favorite chicken. That's actually kind of sad.
Do you remember
one of the... A little concerning. Okay, go ahead.
What was one of the fun facts about the Jubilee Orpington?
Well, supposedly with these types of breeds, every time they molt, they get more white spots.
Isn't that awesome? Yeah. I love that.
And that would be the case with the Millefleur, which would be one of my favorites.
All right, so number one is next.
Okay, what is it?
Well, do we have any guesses out there?
So we had Jared Pollard said just a Wyandotte. I should have said that you were very specific with your, because you have like four Wyandottes on your list.
And that's what I want people to realize. There's so many different colors of Wyandottes, Orpingtons.
Is it the silver-laced Cochin?
You're cheating.
No, it was, yay!
So I...
Because we did get that awesome batch of those from Welp.
Yes.
Welp? Yeah, it was Welp.
And I'll be honest with you.
Man, those were awesome birds. Those were like show quality, amazing. I'm putting it on my list.
Yes, and this is actually probably why the silver-laced Cochin is my number one. It is so hard.
So I did guess Cochin, though, from the very beginning. I knew that you liked those big, fluffy, booted...
There is a hatchery that they need to sponsor us because I plug them all the time. Great customer service. Of course, we all know about Murray McMurray. Never had any issues with them.
You know, somebody from Texas just called in about where they should get their chicks from. And this is a point that we need to make right now is with COVID and with mail delays and everything else, more than the hatchery, you might want to look for a closer hatchery, because I knew in Texas they have Ideal Poultry, which is right there within the state. Mm-hmm. So I said, just this year, I would recommend that you get your chicks
absolutely
from somewhere closer than to get, you know, just like Murray McMurray's in Iowa. So check where these hatcheries are located, because that could mean
life
dead chicks.
Yeah, life absolutely. Or death. Love Ideal Poultry.
And everybody loves live chicks and nobody likes dead chicks.
Yeah, that is true. So the Silver Lace Cochin is, we bought them from Whelp.
Yeah.
Three or four times. And every single time. So I ended up calling Whelp, Patrick, going, how is it you are producing a Silver Lace Cochin so beautiful? They were booted like they had giant snowshoes.
Oh, it was, yeah.
They were just
so amazing.
So beautiful. And they said their breeder was out of New Mexico. And I wanted, when we were out in New Mexico doing the custom coop, to see if I had the opportunity to go meet this breeder, because they're just absolutely gorgeous. So the point to that is, it could even make a difference what breeder you're getting from. Again, just like dogs, you know? So even if you got a breed that you're kind of disappointed, that doesn't mean that's the end all be all, you know, when it comes to how dark the egg's going to be or whatever. Right. That's the beauty of chickens. And I tell you, the Silver Lace Cochin, if I could only have one chicken for the rest of my life, it would have to be the Silver Lace Cochin, and more importantly, from that breeder. Just absolutely gorgeous. So if you like the Silver Lace Cochin, I can't emphasize enough, check out Whelp. And I don't remember, I think they're in the Midwest as well. And hopefully this chick season coming up, it won't be so bad. We broke 50. The show's growing back up again. I can't thank you guys enough right now. That's awesome.
Do you want to get to some questions?
Yes, let's get to some questions. Are you disappointed in my number one?
No, I guessed it.
Yeah, she got it right.
No, I guessed it.
I know you
it
guessed.
It took me a little while. Well, actually, I guessed Cochin from the very beginning, but it's misspelled again.
I know. I can't take it.
Yeah.
Oops. Why is this not right? Is this right? Okay, it is right. I'm sorry.
Oh, and another thing that I love about Americanas that I didn't say before is their colored legs. I just think that those colored legs are so lovely. You can have the steel gray legs. You can have the olive legs. And for some reason, the big stocky orange or yellow legs remind me of an ugly meat chicken sometimes.
I was shocked you left that point
out. I know. I can't believe I forgot. So I have to remind you that the legs on the Americana are so lovely.
Right, they got that olive green color, and you used to point that out all the time.
Well, they can be like a dark steel gray, too. Those are just amazing. So I do like that. I think they just look stately.
Hit the like button. Someone says hit the like button. There's a like button. That's right. They can like this, right?
Yeah.
Everyone, hit the like button right now. Hit it, hit it, hit it. Hit it, share it, subscribe, hit the bell if you haven't already.
There you go. So Anthony Dibna wants to know, should you have two of the same breed to keep each other company?
No. You're wasting a chicken slot on on a duplicate. So yeah. No duplicates if you can stand it. And also, if you're going to name them, how are you going to tell them apart? Mm. Which, I mean, you really should. Yeah. Or, you know, if you're trying to identify who's laying and who's not, my first flock of six that I ever got, they all had slightly different eggs. Even the browns, you know, between the brown egg layers were a slightly different shade. And I would give away eggs with their little names written on the egg in a pencil. I mean, I was that, yeah.
So that is a question we get a lot, is do I have to have all the same breed?
No, please don't. Yes. That's just a waste.
Mix it up. But I want to say my father, of course, I probably said, oh, yeah, no, mix it up. No, oh, no, I'm not going to listen to you. He got all the same, and now he regrets it.
Yeah, I wish I would have done his starter flock for him.
Yes, mix it up, mix it up, mix it up. Absolutely.
Excuse me. I'm going to publish my top three starter flocks.
So we did talk about that a little bit, because I know your feelings were a little hurt. Like, doesn't anyone care what my favorite breeds are? Not yet. But now they will.
Okay.
You have so many people complimenting you right now on your chicken knowledge. Yes.
So we're getting all these questions.
All right, let's go. That's it, Ingrid. Come on, keep track. Keep us focused.
So Seamus wants to know, are Orpingtons as good as they claim for the first-time chicken owners?
As good as they claim. They are. I have an issue with the claims because they're just, a lot of times, very general. I don't know what the claim is.
Well, I was told that they're like the golden retriever of chickens. Like they're like the lap dogs. Like they're very friendly.
I would say that they are. I've never had one that was not friendly.
May I share something to help with this?
Yes.
So advice I give people, and I love to do this, and I know in today's day with our smartphones, you know, we go right to the electronics, but I love, and again, Murray McMurray's not paying for this. I'm just going to say this because I love their catalog.
Yeah, and their catalog is awesome.
And there are, you know, other hatcheries that have great catalogs. But either way, you can call and get a free catalog or email, whatever. And they'll send you a great catalog, and it's great reading material.
My catalog, when it comes, is on my bed.
In your bed, in the bathroom.
Like, I really look at it before I fall asleep.
So, and here's
and
why.
And my kid comes in and says, Mom, you're sleeping on your catalog.
I believe it. Here's the point that I want to make to people. If you're thinking about getting a flock, and we don't, again.
I asked Elise yesterday what her favorite breed was, because you told me about what the title of the show was and you wouldn't tell me anything else. It's the Polish. I noticed the Polish wasn't in your list. And she said just because they're so fun.
I was going to mention the top three to not get, and that's number three. but I've had them, and I do love them, but they can be slightly challenging.
Yeah, they can be.
Hold on, real quick. So
I'm sorry to interrupt you.
When people say claim, they claim things, and you're going to read that. I was trying to bring up the Buff Orpington. I was going to read it. Because you're going to see, you know, they're going to make some claims in here. And I don't want people to get hung up on it.
Yes, please don't.
No.
But you could kind of,
Chickens, one of the things we love about chickens is they break the rules. They have their own rules and they break them all the time.
And they are individuals.
Yeah, they are.
Even within the breed, they're very, can be very
different.
So
just like we wouldn't want to judge people's personality based on how they look, we don't want to do that with chickens.
Right. So I want to use that as an example. I just thought it'd be fun to read real quick, but take my word for it.
And I've seen just a huge variety in a Rhode Island Red. I've had some really smart Rhode Island Reds that knock on the back door. And I had one Rhode Island Red, remember, in the springtime when I had the back door wide open. This Rhode Island Red would sneak in the house, go all the way upstairs, lay an egg upstairs.
You're really going to share the story?
Yeah. I mean, and then I didn't even know this. I would see her occasionally leave the house. I'm like, what the hell? And then sometime later, I found a clutch of like 12 eggs upstairs. I'm like, how did I not notice a hen go inside the house and
people
upstairs that many days?
People are going to have a lot of questions. Yeah. And I can vouch.
I mean, it's just in the nice, you know, it's in the spring when it's nice.
It's a true.
And I had a Rhode Island Red that would knock on the back door. And when I didn't answer, she would go around the front of the house and knock on the front windows. And like look in the windows at me, like it just almost freaky.
This is a true story.
Yeah. And then I've had some Rhode Island Reds that were just like mean.
So be careful what people claim.
So there's, yeah, there's a lot of variety, I think, in a Rhode Island
Mix
Red.
It up. And again, it has so much to do mm-hmm. with how you raise them.
Right.
I often refer to dogs. A lot of people have dogs. And that's.
Oh, did you find the Orpington?
I didn't. And I wanted to use it as an example. Yeah, like I'm sure it says a lot of good things. And they're known to be friendly. And I've never had one that's not friendly. Of course you found it. Jeez, I was looking.
They did come from England, and I love that all of these different breeds come from a different part of the world. So when I make a starter flock, sometimes I'll throw in just
yeah. I was
that
gonna
kind
put
of information.
The country's flag on the keynote slide.
Right. This says that they're wonderfully quiet. Their loose, fluffy feathers keep them warm. Excellent setters.
What does
and
that
mothers,
mean?
Broody.
Oh, okay, yes. Would you agree with that? Yeah, boy.
I guess I haven't had that many Orpingtons, but yeah, if you want broody, the Cochin, the Bantams.
Yeah, you're a little snobby when it comes to your chicken breeds. That's
I mean,
for sure.
I've had Americanas go broody very regularly. Mm-hmm. I've had Wyandottes go broody.
Not so much the Orpingtons. Okay.
I've had a Polish go broody a lot.
No.
So Melissa's asking how about which different breeds get along better with different breeds? Do you find that that's even a thing?
No.
Doesn't matter.
No. And that's one of the most wonderful things about chickens is they never forget who their sisters are. I mean, you could throw together it doesn't even matter. Like Bantam, standard size, all different kinds. And if they grow up together, they are bonded for life. And it is just, I'm getting goosebumps.
Yeah,
it's just so cool.
Right, and when they go out in free range, they stay in their own little clique. It's incredible.
I've got a lot of land, and I noticed that the different years that were raised together forage together. Like, you know, so those last years, they are all together, and then the year before that, they're all together. And then they do mingle somewhat, but really, when it comes to their family, they just never forget who their sisters are. So it doesn't matter as long as they're raised together. And even if they're not, they end up getting along well enough. I mean, kind of like family these days.
So again, then there's a comment. I'm not sure how to pronounce it. Luli, Lali, whatever. Mm-hmm. But there you go. we take it for granted. And that's why I love this show. Is I want to share with people the things that we had to learn that we forget. But yes, there's so many different breeds. And especially, you know, we're advocates of people that are on the fence thinking about, should I get chickens or not? It is so easy if you got the right coop, and it is so much fun. And there are so many different breeds. That is one of the reasons why it is so much fun, being able to put together your own flock.
I love one of each. That's just my that's my philosophy when it comes to chickens.
Yeah, I mean, imagine, I would love to see you pick your top 25. It's not easy.
No. Ekan Thomason, she said Swedish, so I'm guessing it's the Swedish flower hen that she's referring to, which are beautiful chickens.
I don't know that one.
Oh, I'll go find one. Please stand by.
Please stand by. Well, while you're doing that.
And when I pick my favorite 25, I'm going to put them in a shopping cart online, and then I'll check out. I'll let you know what that bill is.
So I brought up an old video from a pure English breed, and I...
Ingrid, what is your favorite breed?
Oh, man.
If you could only have one chicken.
Oh. I don't...
Yeah, it's not easy.
No,
it's not. Yeah, it's not easy. Yeah, everyone's busting my balls by my list. Let's see your list. Then the top three aren't easy.
I don't know.
I mean, if you don't want to say one, what about your top three?
No. You got to put them in order.
I don't. I would definitely have an Orpington.
What kind?
I don't know. Now that I love the lavender or the blue.
I like those.
All right, there's two. You got one more left.
No. I said or.
Mm-hmm. Oh, what? Which is it?
No, come on.
And then,
yeah, come on, yeah.
I love my little bantam.
Oh, yes. Oh, the one that magically appeared.
Yeah, no, not that one.
No, Midge, my little like old English game millefleur bantam. She's adorable. I would probably have something like that.
I call those purse chickens.
Yeah. But she doesn't count. So
they don't count in with your numbers. Of course they count.
Yeah, but they definitely count. It's tough. I love my Brahma, and I mean a Bard Rock is amazing. I don't know. I would, and a Wyandotte. I don't know. I couldn't choose just top 3.
I have two dark Brahmas. I would choose a dark Brahma over those ugly Brahmas that you just showed any day of the week. And because the dark Brahma has the really fine penciling. And I believe it might even be a double pencil. And the Brahmas that I got from the farm store this spring are just amazing. They are so fat and so booted. They are really beautiful.
Mine as well.
Yeah. They're gorgeous.
Yeah.
And this is one of the reasons why chicken math.
And I think the penciling might be my favorite. My second favorite, especially the double pencil. You know, the Wyandotte's penciled, but the Partridge and some other ones are double penciled, which means that every feather is outlined like with a Sharpie on the outside and a thinner Sharpie on the inside. Like, it's just, and that may not be exactly technically correct, but it's really, really pretty.
So, Ingrid, you were going to bring up something, but I see there's some more comments, so I'm not sure. I know I'm controlling the mouse, and you're going to get mad at me, but there's some interesting comments here. And again, these comments help us learn whether we're doing a good job.
I want to know how Lowly found our podcast. He's new to chickens.
Right. And then there's someone else says, I don't own any chickens yet. That's why I'm here to learn. So I love that. That is why we do
this
show.
Famous.
Yes. That means so much to me because obviously I want you to buy from us. I want you to buy our coop. If you're going to build your own coop, and this is where the premise of the show is really to help teach you the things to think about when building your own, not telling you to copy us or follow our recipe or call us whatever.
I used some of our concepts when I built a chicken coop for my daughter, so maybe we could show that off one day.
Maybe one day. Maybe. I gotta go see it first. It's kind of like
why don't you come see it?
Yeah, I'll come down and see it.
Why don't you bring a water bar with you?
But I want people to realize this is one of the best hobbies you can get in. And the other thing too, when it comes to the chickens, we talked about this at that site survey, is how therapeutic they can be, and people don't even realize it. Yeah. Until they get them.
We have greetings from Lithuania. Huge fan. and asks, does the pecking order change if no new birds are added or removed?
Mm. May I hold on one real quick before you answer that? My father, did he tell you what's going on?
Yes.
And he did something interesting. I don't know if it was your advice or what happened. It's the opposite of what I thought you should do in this situation. I've never had to do it. But make sure we talk about that a little bit.
Well, because you're talking cryptically. Can you explain what you're talking about?
What are you talking
like
about?
In code.
Yeah, go ahead and address it.
So, what is the pecking order?
The pecking order is their social system. It's their social hierarchy, which is another reason why chickens are so interesting, is they have a leader and they have, it's almost like the old fashioned serf system where they have like, and sometimes when they're raised together as sisters, as chicks, it's not as a parent. And sometimes it's really so variable. That's why I'm talking over myself and just babbling like an idiot, but
no, I think you're doing great.
No, it really is just a social system,
and it's really not as complicated as I think some people make it out to be.
And you may not notice the nuances unless you observe your flock quite a bit. But there is clearly someone that is a leader in the flock, and then there are ones that are lower in the pecking order that might get picked on. And where you see this the most is when you have in the hen house a stair-stepped stadium seating roost, which we don't have in our chicken coops, which is why it may not be as apparent in some of ours. But the top roost is where you're going to have all your highest pecking order hens. And I've had hens that will peck the feet of the one next to them and move them off the top when they're not supposed to be there. And it's like, what are you doing in this seating area? You have to go down.
Right. So to that point, mm-hmm. and we've had people, YouTube Chicken Police, say you should only have what we call bleacher style roost bar positioning.
Bleacher style.
Yes.
I didn't say that. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah,
Because they have to have that so they can establish the pecking order. And then I have other experts. Mm-hmm. And this is what we do, because I feel like this makes the most sense and we've seen it work, is keep it level so that we avoid maybe a little bit more fighting. But they say, no, that's not going to help them establish their pecking order.
I wouldn't say you could do either one. Yeah. I think it's more of a space issue.
I like the level, but I think, again, we don't want to overthink it, but I think the level works. And often when I hear you on the phone talking to people, about having an aggressive chicken, trying to figure out which one it is, we always refer, it's usually the one that's the prettiest, best looking one.
Your prima donna hen is the bitch.
Right. So
sorry.
But the question is, if you don't add to your flock, or does the pecking order change? Is it always, once it's established?
It usually is established for life, but when you see weakness in a chicken, they can lose their position.
Yeah, I had a circumstance where it was six chickens raised together. And they had a very established pecking order. And the one on the bottom decided to pick on one of the top hens.
Ooh,
and she just totally did like a coup.
Uh-huh.
And it was a coup in the coop. And she became,
in the coop.
She became, I blogged about it. She became a higher up chicken. So, which was very unusual because there was no environment change. There was no new chickens. She just decided.
She just got some gusto.
Yeah.
Something happened. So the answer would be yes, I guess it can.
It can.
Very rare, though.
And let that be a lesson to all of us. If you're not satisfied with your position in life, here in America, we can better ourselves. Just like that chicken. What was her name?
Louise.
Louise. Be a Louise if you want to be a Louise.
We got some great t-shirt ideas here.
Be a Louise.
Be a Louise. And
I'm not happy with my position here.
Really?
No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah, you
were sweating.
But okay, so here's what my father is having this problem.
Yes.
He has an aggressive hen pecking at some of his girls, bad.
Mm-hmm.
So they tried that blue treatment.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what it is and why.
It's blue coat. It's just something you put on them so they can't see. So the wounds can heal and the other hens don't see it.
Don't see the red.
Yeah. So
there is truth that will trigger an aggression, not just curiosity. Like our nipples are red.
Right.
And they're attracted to it.
Speak for yourself. No.
See, I'm not allowed to say any of that for the record, but welcome to the party, Ingrid. anyways, You lost me now. You got me on
okay,
that.
Okay, so what about your dad's chicken?
A fun fact. Years ago in the 60s, someone invented red glasses for chickens. So to eliminate the pecking. Mm-hmm. And the reason why they're pecking so much is because the living situations that when commercial factory farming started coming out were just
horrible.
And
then they just started chopping their beaks off.
Yes. No. Awful. He isolated the aggressive one. Mm-hmm. And I was curious what your thoughts are. You know, and I know people deal with this all the time. He is free ranging. He has a huge pen outside his run, has a big run, but they're isolated the aggressive one. Mm-hmm. And the other ones are doing better. What's your opinion on that?
I think that's good because once that one comes back to the flock, it may have to reestablish its pecking order, which, I mean, could go either way.
That's what he said. It said it's a reset mm-hmm. in their mind mm-hmm. even. Very interesting.
He wanted to take the wounded one or the one that was in the bottom inside, I believe, or maybe it was another customer. I said that would be, no, don't do that because that's going to be traumatic for that chicken to be all alone. And then when you put it back out there, everyone's going to peck at it to establish their position again. So taking them away is not going to help anything.
Taking away the weak ones, but take away the aggressive ones.
Right, So I definitely like that.
Okay, that's good. All right, so that's all I wanted to get to there because I tell you, it's interesting, but it is something that does happen. And my advice to prevent that is this is why free ranging is so important.
Yeah. I've had one chicken and it was a partridge rock that was so aggressive and mean to the other hens that eventually I had to just give her away. And when she went to a friend's house had, she had a rooster and she said that hen and the rooster are just a pair. Like she loved that rooster and that rooster loved her. So she ended up with a happy ending, but I couldn't keep up. The drama was just too much. I mean, she would have to have a whole roost bar to herself. She would peck the feet of all the other ones.
Naomi Thomas. Little shout out. She's the one that called yesterday.
I'm going to give you a call.
Okay. I apologize. Naomi, I did my job. She was supposed to call this morning before the show. I apologize. I said, Naomi, please come to the show. You'll learn so much because she's brand new into think about getting chickens. And it was a referral from an existing customer out in the Midwest, which I love. Oh, I love when our customers are our best.
I'm going to be on the road for 13 hours if anyone wants to call and talk about chickens, especially during the middle of the night.
So Naomi wants to know, she doesn't know anything about chickens. So where does she start?
Right here. Where do I start? Video chicken. Giving us a call. And I can tell you that why I love for people to call us, and I know that's a little bit of a debate behind the scenes with the click and buy and the website. I want to give people options, but if you educate yourself properly, you will realize why we do what we do. Especially when I'm in the chicken coop business. And I do get people often that say, God, your coops are so expensive. Those are $30,000 eggs, whatever. You have to understand that it's not that our coops are technically expensive. They can. We do have a very affordable coop. And I love when people mention, Matt, I went to build a coop and you were right. I should have just saved the money and yada, yada, yada. But start with calling us, to be honest with you. Watch our videos.
And we have a lot of information on our website.
A lot of information. And what I tell people is listen to what we say and identify the common denominator. And then when you go out and do other research, and just like we had, Adalia from Chickenlandia, never talked to her before, but here is a true chicken lover, and she's saying the same thing.
Yeah.
And it's just because that's what you need to hear. Mm-hmm. I swear there are some people out there that are just using their chickens to make money, which, you know, I there's nothing wrong with making money, but I think they give misinformation to make money, and that's what I think is wrong. But give us a call, and always... We emphasize this, I'm sure you do as well. What did chickens do before coops were invented? And that's what we have to think about. We got to keep it simple.
And I think when you get started, don't let the coop be an afterthought because that's where you run into a lot of problems. The right way to do it is to get your coop first or at least that process going before you get your baby chicks. And almost anywhere in the country, I'm sure, has farm stores where you can get baby chicks in the spring. And there's usually a very good selection, especially if you call around and you go from shop to shop, which I used to publish a list of what the farm stores, I did a like a consolidated list for all the local people here about what all the farm store schedules were. So you could make your plan and go from store to store and pick out your starter flock. So there's usually a lot of variety that you can get in your local area.
Absolutely.
Or just, I mean, my first chickens, I just teamed up with some other people and we did a group order from a hatchery. But if anyone's going to do local chick buying, it would be this year or in last year, just because of the potential issues. And I'm not 100% sure all those are worked out, right, especially since they say that the post office expect delays, et cetera.
And it's probably going to happen again. Yeah. And I tell you, I predicted years ago that chicken breeding is, it's going to, and you're seeing it.
Mm-hmm.
They are picking their favorite breed and just breeding quality chickens. And then, of course, there's a lot of breeders that have multiple different breeds, and there's going to be more and more availability. You are going to pay more, but in the grand scheme of things, it's so well worth it. You know, some people are like, why would I buy a $2 chicken and put them in a, you know, $3,000-$5,000 chicken coop? But a lot of it's because you have no idea. There is time invested into raising your baby chicks, and you got to make sure you keep them safe.
Right.
And again, what other pet is going to give you back such a healthy, wholesome breakfast? So it's just so important to look around local. I would definitely agree with that. But don't be scared too of checking out the hatcheries, even just to learn and get the free catalogs.
Sleep with your catalog.
But you know, anyways, so I see there's a lot of comments we didn't go over. Ingrid's streaming by them, and yeah, she tries to like skip a lot, but I don't want to. But it is 1:25. Can we do a quick 5-minute rundown? Is there anything
sure
else?
Sure. Okay. You want me to start from the beginning? Is that what you want?
Well, I want to start right from the beginning. Yeah, because I tell you again, I love. Hold on, let me hijack here. Oh, here. So the show's gaining again. I can't thank everyone
add
enough.
The comments and, to the view.
Well, there's a lot of...
She took them off, and I'm like, oh, what's going on here? So I got to be careful.
I'm trying to change it up for people.
All right.
All right.
Oh, and someone said time to clip their wings. That was probably about my...
Yes.
Why I ran into the fence post.
And that was Jessica and Tim, by the way, that
yeah
said that.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because I was trying to get the chicken before it went into the tree.
That's why I don't want to put these up, because they're old.
Okay. Right. I understand.
Just
I can't
let Ingrid handle it, Matt.
Well, mobile
Come
chicken,
on, back off.
Mobile chicken coops back in the off works. Hey, there's no touching my mouse. There's no touching the mouse.
Just let her do it.
So, yes, Chris Meek is asking, mobile chicken coops in the work, because it's a thing. How do you feel about mobile chicken coops? Are they like how you feel about silkies? Tell us.
Right. So, real quick, this is going to be the what do you call it? The quick shot fire. All right. So, mobile chicken coops in the works. Everything's always in the works. I'm not a fan of them. I always tell people, what you need to know is let the chickens move, not the coop. And there's many reasons why. But we have done them. I would love to have a mobile chick coop. I do have one that I'm not sure whatever happened. I did show it off where it did make sense to me what we were going to do.
Do you all make rabbit coops?
We have made rabbit coops.
We have made a lot of rabbit coops. Rabbit coops are, and I don't know if it's really rabbit coop, rabbit hutch. They're becoming more and more popular.
Oh, yeah.
I love it. I absolutely love it.
Because they're pets and meat, just like chickens, dual purpose.
Yes. And we've done them where they have chickens and rabbits in the same structure as
well.
Yeah, that
makes sense. I was just about to ask.
Yep.
Yep.
So we absolutely do. There's nothing we can't
They're
make.
Separated, though, right?
Yes.
Yeah, they have different feed.
Yep.
Different, yeah.
Chris Meek is also saying that for eggs, black Australorps and Isa Browns, and they also have great attitudes as chickens.
Yeah, Isa Browns are a good egg layer. Black Australorps. I never had a black Australorps, but it is a popular breed.
Yeah, yeah. Really, all of these backyard breeds are, I mean, they're all personable. That's what they're bred for. They're bred for the eggs and for being great backyard chickens. That's why you see so many of the backyard, and when you get eggs from a friend or someone's backyard, you'll see so many brown eggs, because those brown egg layers have been bred to be backyard chickens, the dual purpose breeds that are originated from Europe.
I didn't know that.
Lot of times when you see the white eggs, like the leghorns, you're not going to see a lot of white, pure white eggs, like a leghorn egg in a backyard egg basket, because those typically have been the more flighty and harder to manage chickens. So you're not going to see so many of those.
That's interesting. I never knew that.
Yeah.
I want to give Martin a shout out. Martin's from Germany, and he had his daughter sent us a video of his coop that he built based on our design. And he said one of the hardest things to find was the gate latches that you use for...
Really?
Which you wouldn't even think of, but in Germany it was impossible for them to find.
We're having a hard time.
Yeah, well, so he says I have, was it Bielefeld chickens? I don't know my German. Matt's going to take it. They're very robust and easy to care for beginners and a heavy chicken. So it's Bielefeld.
I've never heard Bielefeld. Bielefeld. I don't know.
Yes, you got to say it in a German accent.
Was that good?
Yeah, it was good.
My other half is Semmel.
But I do like to give him, because I meant to show his video on shows many months ago.
I cannot wait till we have a shop in Europe. And I tell you, the biggest question is, what country do we go to? And being the fact that we just had the best lumber ever from France and Germany, I think, is a tip-off.
But, a lot of corporations are moving to Ireland. I know when I worked at IBM, my boss was in Ireland.
In Ireland, I tell you, I got...
They must have some business-friendly, maybe some... Oh, and even like Microsoft or someone has...
Something's going on with Ireland,
yeah,
for sure.
They have some headquarters over there. So, yeah, there's...
And I wouldn't mind having a shop there. I think that would sound cool. Like, we're in Ireland. It's time to go drinking.
And they do speak English.
Yes. So. And they don't judge you if you're... Oh, well, hold on now. See, you're flying
And
through.
They have Guinness.
So... What rooster breed is the... No. You're not going anywhere. You... No.
Why is she leaving?
Because she gets mad. So what rooster breed is the
Did
nicest?
I miss something? I want
to
get mad.
This Anthony Dibna. This is a great question. Because we never... The only time I mentioned the rooster was actually with the very... Number 25. The black-tailed white Japanese. Yeah. Because we're not huge fans of roosters because they cause so many problems. But they are beautiful. But I thought about this one particular rooster when I was making this list last night. And he was the coolest rooster. And I don't know if it was because of the breed. Could have been. But he was a Bard Cochin. He was the coolest rooster. Yeah, but what rooster breed is the nicest? I don't know if you can...
I really don't. I haven't had enough experience with roosters. But I have had a couple really nice roosters. I think my nicest was the Black Copper Maron. He was so cool. Just, I mean, I could pick him up. I brought him on camera once during the show. He was just totally laid back.
Yeah, and I had two.
But he did his job too.
The blue lace red Cochin roosters. Mm-hmm. I had two of them. They were super friendly. It's just so hard to say that. It's really.
I think a lot of that is how they're raised. Right,
go ahead, Ingrid. Go ahead and scroll down. I just thought that was a great question.
Well, okay.
A great question, which we didn't really answer.
You really didn't. Yeah.
Because you can't really answer it.
Right.
Well.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So here's one. James, FB07074. One of my chickens is molting. What can I do to keep her healthy as colder weather sets here in Pennsylvania?
The answer is not knit her a sweater.
Yeah.
It's to help her grow her feathers back by providing the right nutrition for her. The pellets, the chicken feed is essential, but you can also add some extra protein.
Which would be?
From your kitchen or mealworms.
Black oil, sunflower seed.
Yeah.
Tuna fish. My chickens love tuna.
Yeah.
I know someone that doesn't. Rejected lunch last week.
Brought my own.
Yeah.
Interesting. I tell you...
It's
not because I'm a chicken coop builder, but this is why I love chicken coops. It has so much to do with the structure. Number 85, that's it?
Number 85.
Number 85.
Okay, so yeah, and also I've been bartering for years. I get spent grains from brewers, people who brew their own beer. That's great for chickens. I get venison scraps. I get somebody is into canning, and I just got a big tray of the scraps from canning rotisserie chickens. So... I get, like, people's leftovers from Thanksgiving.
Wouldn't the coop have something to do with this as well? I mean, we're talking about healthy. If we storm shields, block the wind
right,
chill.
Right. Oh, yeah, no, yeah, that I mean, too.
Okay,
but I'm just saying there are lots of ways to get extra protein. I mean, people's maybe even a commercial kitchen. I'm just saying that you can be creative. Oh, and another thing that I did this week is I went leaf hunting. And it was only the first time this season that I've gone leaf hunting, and I was afraid I was too late. But... I went to go get my chicken scraps from the venison hunter. And on the way back, there were a whole row of beautiful bagged leaves on the curb. And I got 10 in my Camry. So.
Family tradition, folks.
Yes. I grew up leaf hunting and my children are leaf hunters. So occasionally they'll stop and bring me some bags of leaves. So.
They love it. They absolutely yeah, love those
it's
leaves.
It's the thrill of the hunting.
And I'll never forget that you were able to like, oh, those are good leaves. What?
Oh, yeah.
Like, how can you tell good leaves from bad leaves just yeah. by...
I had a suitor once. Do you remember that? Some guy was interested in me and he thought he knew that I did this. So he thought he would be, like try to gain my favor by bringing me a bunch of bagged leaves, but they weren't the clear bags. So what he brought me were like
such
20,
a rookie move.
Yeah, it didn't work and I didn't end up dating him. But it was like 20 bags of poison ivy. Yeah, I was like, okay, no, sorry. And then where am I going to get rid of 20 bags of poison ivy?
That's when you bring in goats, the goats.
Goats. Goats love poison ivy.
Damn.
I just want to give a shout out to Francine. Thank you again. Always here. Yeah. Kristen, your chicken knowledge is amazing. Oh, all
yeah.
capital.
Yeah, Francine's great.
Yes, I tell you, that's why I love bringing Mackenzie in. I wish I could bring just everyone this in
is,
from the steam.
And this is just so fun.
It is fun. But again, this is why I love this show, because this is why I want people to realize why it's so nice, not just to buy a good product from us, but what you're supporting. You know, the people that love what they do and we give it back, and just can't thank you guys enough. So moving on. And then I think we did probably get through some of these. We'll go real quick. I know Ingrid's getting mad at me. Oh, I did want Lisa Haymaker says, in North Carolina, check out the Carolina Chick Hatchery.
Yeah, I wrote that down.
I never heard of them.
I didn't either.
Yeah, she says they have a Facebook page. If you do go into Facebook, there are lots of people that are breeding their own right now. And they're usually in backyard chicken groups in your local state or area. And you can. This would be the year to go about that. Just and everybody's hatching in the spring, so.
And don't forget, you can hatch your own too.
Right, you have to have an incubator, so there's some expense in that.
Or a broody.
And maybe a trial and error too. But if you're just starting in with chickens, you don't have a broody, unless you can buy a broody. I have sold off my broodies before. Just for that.
Do you like the silkies? I think that question's for you.
Or else I haven't been watching the show enough.
Yeah. Matt doesn't like silkies, but I like silkies. I think they're just fine. They're not great for egg laying, but they make great mothers. And I think I've said in the past, there's a huge difference in a show silky, which is going to have less
enough.
Brain and more head feathers, which is going to make it look beautiful and cute, but kind of brainless. Versus the hatchery silkies, which still have a lot of those chicken instincts and really become part of the flock, just like their standard sized chickens. So I would be a little hesitant to get show silkies just because of my experience. They didn't last long. They wouldn't go into the coop at night. And, you know, it only took one night for us to forget that there's a silky sitting in the middle of the yard.
So silkies for inside enclosed back porch with hidden run to be covered as much as possible, question mark.
Oh, well, yeah, if that would be appropriate for a silky to be more of a pet. It sounds like more of a hidden outlaw.
I'll tell you, I'll never forget that reptile show. And I meant to bring up the picture. Yeah. I got to, but that silky just sat right there at a reptile show.
Right.
So what do you know about, is this, we didn't, Styrian hen? It's an old heritage breed.
I don't know that one.
I don't know that one, but that would be fun to look up.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, Styrian. I've never heard of that. I'm building, but buying my watering system from Carolina Coops. Thank you.
Thank you, Seamus.
Appreciate that. Is everything back in stock?
No.
This is where I should have Mackenzie on. You guys see, get Mackenzie get fired
no,
up.
No, you can. Okay, so you can buy our basic poultry watering system, and then you can go to the products that we love page, and you can see if, because we can't control the stock on some of the stuff, which is why we're not selling the whole heated poultry watering system, because we can't guarantee stock on everything.
And we also are not allowed to order in bulk from the manufacturers right now.
Are you back from your pedicure already? That was fast.
That we were asked to come back in about an hour.
Oh, okay. Just well, that made me a little nervous. I didn't hear what she said. I was still in shock.
So we're not allowed to buy in bulk from the manufacturer.
Isn't that crazy?
Right now.
Golly.
So you order our basic poultry watering system, which is fantastic, and then you go to the products we love, and then you can click on and see, okay, here's the rain barrel, is the heated... So the only thing it doesn't come with is the rain barrel and the heating element inside the rain barrel. It comes with everything else and the heated, I believe.
So here's the wonderful website, and I just want to give them a visual. We never take advantage of this. This is the beauty of this technology. So shop, mm-hmm. products we love.
And replacement parts.
And replacement parts. And this is coming up a lot, and it is wintertime. Don't feel like it here. God, I love the Carolinas. It's loading a little slow. Well, probably because we're streaming.
Yeah.
So you come here and then you can order it to make it up, to drop ship it. And that reminds me of something. I was just going to mention something that I haven't done yet. I apologize, Ingrid. I promise I'm going to do it. But we can go ahead and do it. And I want to see if you, knowing you, you probably already got it done.
Mm.
No, you probably did. I think you did. I tell you, you're on point. Where would it be? We're going to start off. So we obviously we can do custom water bars, but I want to start standardizing the 2 foot, 4 foot, which we already do, 6 foot and 8 foot. And we shipped out an 8 foot the other day. It's great.
Just slightly less than 8 feet.
Yes. Oh, right. Yeah. That's right. You sold it. The problem was to go from 6 foot to 8 foot, it costs so much to ship it.
Yeah. As long as you don't go over 8 feet. Well, that's why it was slightly less than 8 feet.
Well, that is true, but still, to go from 6 foot to 8 foot, it was crazy. Oh, no, that was roost bars roost that I'm thinking about, but it's probably the same thing. It had everything to do with the footage. So,
right.
Anyways, this is what Ingrid's talking about, just a great, great website, and you're doing an awesome job. And if you guys ever have any suggestions for the website, please let us know. We are doing everything we can to make it a wonderful shopping experience, but more importantly, how did you hurt yourself?
My shoulder's bad. All right,
that means, yeah, I know, we're 10 minutes past our cutoff time, but... we're trying to streamline it for the click and buy, but also I want you to learn. And you should be able to do that from our website. All right?
So this is your basic poultry watering system. And you can add to it to make this a heated watering system. And so this is in stock. And then you can check out the other components that you
need. Right, and you don't have to have a high-density polyethylene food-safe rain barrel. You might have a pickle barrel. You know, it's amazing how creative you can get.
Yeah, one of our customers in California has a stainless steel barrel.
Really? I didn't know that.
The one we're doing the elevations for his HOA.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
Right. That is nice. I have a pickle barrel from Mount Olive Pickles here in North Carolina.
A pickle barrel.
Mm-hmm.
Fun fact, I tell you, since Mackenzie's been here, I have never seen anyone eat more pickles than her. It is unbelievable how many pickles that girl eats. She loves her pickles. It's crazy. When she had her first visit at Chick-fil-A, she actually asked for extra pickles. All right, just moving on real quick. Okay, we're going to wrap it up. We're going to get through the rest of the comments because I know it's important to me. It's important to our listeners. And I promise we will finish.
I love that Francine said, be a Louise, don't be a Karen.
That is good. We are required to have 3 square feet per chicken here. Most likely inside your hen house. And I tell you, when it comes to figuring out what size coop you should have, that is the most important thing. I am a huge fan of don't get hung up on how many square feet per hen in the hen house. But a lot of local ordinances require that because I guess there's no other way to look at it.
Some of those might be outdated back when they had chicken houses, like the commercial long ones that they have. It was based on how much floor space you have.
It absolutely was. Yeah. And I remember even
that's
in Durham,
not so relevant now.
You had to have so many square inches to square foot of ventilation, which I could appreciate. You know, I'm not a huge fan of regulation, but I think there should be good guidelines to go by, mm-hmm. but why? But bigger is always better when it comes to chicken coops. But there's more to that. But that is a number that I worry people get hung up on that for the wrong reasons. All right, moving on.
Are you asking me?
I don't know.
You're okay.
There was such a great compliment.
There's a lot of, okay.
Yeah. Okay, then I'm going to go through it. Ingrid's going to be so mad at me later.
Go ahead.
Great show. Glad you're breaking down the difference between the flocks. I love your chick coops. I hope I can save enough funds to purchase here in Detroit, Michigan. We hope so as well. We are going to be bringing out the full kit very, very soon, which is going to hopefully bring the price down. Lumber is going through the roof.
Ugh.
It's insane.
All those projects I was going
to
do.
Here we go again. I can tell you, and again, thank you. We are doing everything we can to make it as affordable as possible.
So I had a small window to do projects, and now it's going back up. Okay.
All right, so moving on, some of the chicken feed you can be soaked in water to ferment, making feed go and further increase nutrition. There is a big thing about that.
Yeah, I think Ingrid knows about that. I'm not up on that.
I do ferment, but I don't ferment my feed. I ferment grains and feed to them. Fermenting, it gives them probiotics naturally, and I just do them in mason jars. But some people do the feed. I just don't want to deal with like 5-gallon
You mean the
buckets.
Pellets?
No, it's just
or the grain.
It's like different grains, a mixture of like seed grains and stuff okay. that I ferment.
That makes sense. If you ferment the if you get the pellets
yeah.
wet, they get nasty.
Yeah, and you don't want mold, so you have to be careful with things like that.
I would love to do a segment on that because it can get a little confusing, but I am a big believer in fermenting.
Mm-hmm.
And I've seen that where you can ferment, like Ingrid's just saying, and there's such huge benefits. And I think if we did a show on that, that would be awesome, especially if we brought maybe Dr. Crespo mm-hmm. back in. And
I contacted the compost expert who sells the biopod for black soldier fly larva, and he wants to come on the show in January.
Cool. Nice. No, I would love that. All right, we made it to the end. And here's Farmer Brad. My quails have laid their first egg. Quails are coming up more and more
yeah,
and more.
Yeah, they are.
They are becoming very, mm-hmm. very – love quail. Again, I love to throw out the fun fact. And I still haven't verified. We need someone with an egg allergy so we can feed them some quail eggs and make sure they don't have an allergic reaction. Because I've been told if you have an egg allergy, you can eat quail eggs and you're good to go.
What about duck eggs?
I don't know. But I would love to put that to the
yeah,
test.
Yeah, if our guinea pig survives that test, we can give that person the duck egg.
Diana, we do sell automatic chicken doors.
We sell automatic chicken doors. If it's chicken related, we sell it. Let's go to the website. Here we go. Do we sell automatic doors? And we love our automatic doors. Where is it, Ingrid?
Coop accessories.
Coop accessories, of course.
All right, just click on the thing.
Yes.
And they did add a blackout option.
Excuse me?
The Chicken Guard Door Company now has a solid black option.
I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm.
So here is the door we sell because we love it. Now, we have tried a lot of automatic doors. I still am going to stick by a statement. I have yet to find the perfect.
There's the blackout.
Oh, wow. I still have yet to find the perfect chicken door. But I tell you, the Chicken Guardian, we love it because
it is good. I love that locking door.
That is probably one of the best parts. So my mind is blown right now. Blackout option. Mm-hmm. Why? Why do the blackout option? Did we call the manufacturer and ask them?
No.
Any idea?
It's their eco version, which really just okay. means that they have some recycled material in the production of it.
Good to know.
And then they made mm-hmm. it black.
Okay, well, I guess that just answered that.
But that's yep. the only difference.
Yeah.
That's awesome. So, yes, we do love it. Go right to our website. It's right here. I believe they are in stock. They get drop shipped. And, yes, this automatic door, this is the little secret right here. It'll lock so a raccoon can't come in here and lift it up. Absolutely love that.
And it can be programmed or it can go dusk to dawn or both.
Yes. So important. And we talked about that at the right there, that photo cell.
Mm-hmm.
I love the photo cell because when the sun comes up, sun goes down, door goes down. But, you know, say you got one of those pesky predators that are nocturnal and they're still, you know, overachievers and they're around at 6 a.m. in the summertime, you can tell this door on the timer not to open until say 8:00, 9:00, and hopefully that nocturnal predator's gone. But then at night, you can still use the photo cell, so you don't have to go out and change the timer. So it is a great, great door, and it's a four AA batteries.
Right.
You don't have to run electric. You don't have to do solar. And I think the manufacturer, if I remember correctly, says 6 months, but we've seen them go over a year.
Yep, I just changed mine.
All right, so it's time to wrap it up. I appreciate you, Ingrid and Kristen, hanging out for this is probably the longest show we've ever done.
Yeah, but I can't. Okay.
Can't do it anymore.
There we go.
And
it took me forever.
But did we have fun? Was that
yes,
not fun?
Yes.
And I'm very proud of you. I knew you would hammer those breeds. They weren't.
Even easy, after though. My concussion. My chicken-related concussion.
What is Kristen's top three, real quick?
Now, there has to be rules. If we're going to ask this, because you guys just yelled at me.
Well, you made me pick three, and I didn't like it. And yeah. I was wondering what Kristen.
I would say a Cochin.
No, what kind?
No.
It would be the modeled Cochin.
See, why am I getting yelled at?
The Americana. And...
Did you say modeled Cochin?
Uh-huh.
Oh, okay.
Because I want those spots.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, and the third...
What's your number one?
A little Banty. You need a Banty.
Oh, yeah, definitely a Bantam.
All right.
What kind?
But it would be hard to choose. Maybe the Millefleur.
See, it's not so hard. It's not so easy, is it?
Yeah, but you got 25. We got three.
So I had to pick the top three. Gosh, I tell you. Anyways, guys. All right. So next week, Christmas Eve.
We don't know.
Yes, we do know.
Oh.
Are you going to be here?
I don't know.
Everyone wants you. Ingrid, we can't do this without you.
Yes, you can.
No, it is so hard.
Do you know that some people celebrate Christmas Eve as if it was Christmas?
No.
Italian people?
I don't know.
I mean, we celebrate Christmas Eve. And then there's Christmas.
And then there's Festivus.
And then there's Festivus.
Festivus for the rest of us. So are you saying you won't be here?
I don't know. I'll probably be here.
We are going to do a Christmas. You're going to be here.
In my family, Festivus is like way above Christmas. So, I mean, that's just us, though.
Yeah, you got a long journey. You're on your way to Florida right now. So you got a long drive, and I kept you late. So I appreciate it. Ingrid, I hope you're here next Friday. If not, I will understand. I'm doing a show Christmas Eve.
With bells on.
Non's got Christmas bells, Christmas lights, Christmas hats. And we already did a test run out in the shop with everyone working. We're just, again, setting up. Santa's workshop with all their Christmas hats on out there working away. So, sorry.
I was right on it.
Okay. All right. Well, I just want to say, so are you going to be here? Are you going to commit?
Yeah.
Christmas Eve, our next show. It'll be the last show of the year.
Yeah, my family's doing Christmas the week before.
Perfect. All right, guys. Thank you so much for taking the time to watch the show. Have a great, great weekend.